universities and intellectual property. Today, IP has become one of the important components of a modern university. You can say that intellectual property is the foundation of the new university. Now, this happened because of a legislation, the Bayh Dole Act, which was promulgated in the United States, which allowed universities to license their inventions for commercial development. Now, before the Bayh Dole Act came into force, any university which was using public funds was not allowed to patent because it involved use of public funds, and patenting with the use of public funds could be seen as privatizing technology which was created using public funds. Now, this act allowed universities to license their inventions and to commercially develop it. You should understand the scope of this act in the light of an age-old exception that was there in patent laws. Patent laws traditionally excluded any activity which was for instruction of their students or any research activity from the ambit of a patent infringement. So, whatever happened within the universities or in the classrooms, though it may fall within the ambit of an infringement, was excluded because that was necessary for teaching students. So, the research or the instruction exception existed in the US law as well. But this came more to ensure the products that are developed in the universities, the intellectual property rights that are created in the universities, could be commercialized. In India, we had a similar attempt. There was a bill which was passed, which covered the public funds used in developing intellectual property. It was called the PUPFIP bill, which stands for the Protection and Utilization of Public Funded Intellectual Property. Now, this bill did not become an act. It failed because of certain controversies surrounding it. So, licensing of patents became a revenue for universities, but not just the universities, but also for the researchers and the professors. So, this is the background of the entrepreneurial university, the university donning the role of an entrepreneur. So, the new university, where the creators of technological solutions and society's growing economic expectations came around the universities. Universities were expected not to just perform their teaching function, but also to ensure that they come up with new technologies and help the society. And IP was used as a tool to harness new technology, because in any area of new technology, it's hard for people to invest unless there is some kind of protection. So we see this in all technologies during the early stage of their life, be it software or biotechnology. We see that initially there is a focus on IP in a new technology, because till then the rights have not crystallized in a way in which people know how their investment can be recouped. So in the initial age of any new industry, you find that there is a focus on intellectual property, so that brings investments. And universities, because they were doing focused research, they were also able to develop and disseminate information of the research and development that happened. Universities also contributed in a way that the IP that protected the initial research could be developed into new products. Now, most of the time, this happened because the university research was taken by a private player, a corporation or an institution which was interested in commercializing it, and took the technology to the market. So, universities were predominantly doing the role of doing the research, but the research that the university would do, the moment it comes within the purview, something that a commercial entity is interested in, then the partnership between the commercial entity and the university would lead to some kind of licensing or even some kind of an entrepreneurship role. Now, universities would largely commercialize their IP in two broad ways. One, they could license the technology that is covered They could license the patents, or the professors and the research team could itself incubate a company, which is what we call the entrepreneurial route. So they could be technology that is developed, could take a licensing route, wherein just the technology is licensed and royalties are earned. Or they could be an entrepreneurial route. Rather than licensing the technology to third parties, that they form a small team, and as a startup, they incubate a company, and the company now tries to commercialize the technology. Now, all this became a part of the university function because it was seen as something that was done for the public good. So teaching had a function that was directed towards the good of the public. Similarly, developing new technologies was also seen as being in alignment with the function of a university to do public good. Now, universities also, as I said, were instrumental in transferring technology. So dissemination of technology for a wider distribution happened through the universities. And in the US especially, more than 5,000 startups have been created since 1980. That is, since the Bayh Dole Act, many startups have come through by using technology that was developed by the universities. In India, the IITs have incubated startups and companies, especially IIT Madras and IIT Bombay. They have a research park which has incubated companies. And the model that has been predominantly followed in India is the licensing of university patents. And incubated companies, if you look at the licensing, there are a few companies that have been incubated, but the predominant model appears to be that of licensing university patents. Now, what is the importance of IP for universities? There are cases where licensing of a blockbuster technology, we refer to a technology as a blockbuster technology if it earns revenues in millions. And there are many instances in the United States. Florida State University was instrumental in coming up with the drug Taxol, which is a cancer drug. It partnered with Bristol Myers Squibb, which is a pharmaceutical company, and it earned revenues of around $45 million for their technology. The University of Minnesota was involved in developing compounds behind Abacavir, which is a HIV/AIDS drug. And this made the university earn more than $370 million. Now, we can see that because of the stakes involved, universities are also likely to fight patent litigation. So there are various cases where universities have fought with companies, universities have fought with other universities, but universities have also fought with their own employees and professors. One case, which was a landmark case in the US, involves Maddy versus Duke University. This decision came out in 2002, where Professor Maddy was employed by Duke University and some disputes rose, and there was an infringement suit filed by Maddy against Duke University. Duke University pleaded research exception, saying that its activities would amount to research and hence it should not technically fall within patent infringement. Professor Maddy, on the other hand, alleged that Duke University was aggressive in commercializing their technology, and hence the research exception, which is normally open for a university which would normally be used for instructing students, should not be open for a university that commercializes its technology. And this was true for all the leading universities in the United States. So the appellate court held that the research exception would not be open to Duke University because of the fact that it commercializes the technology. So in India, we still have a strong research exception. Universities are allowed to do things that could technically amount to patent infringement so far as they are instructing their students and it is done with research objectives, not with commercial objectives. But once universities start commercializing the products of their research, it may be hard to draw a line between research use and commercialization, as it happened in Maddy versus Duke University. Now, recently we had the CRISPR-Cas9 technology, which was a technology used for rewriting snippets of DNA and what we commonly call gene editing. Now, this has raised quite a lot of ethical issues, more than technology-based issues, saying that what could be the outcome, the cost involved in editing genetic material, because most of the time the technique is used at the embryonic stage and researchers are not able to predict what could be the ultimate consequence of these editing. So there are some ethical issues involved as well. And we also have a case where UC Berkeley had a case against Broad Institute of MIT and Harvard. UCB had filed a patent in 2012, and the Broad Institute was the first to win the patent in 2014. This was on an overlapping technology where the two institutions were applying for variations on patents to lock up associated technology. So you find different types of disputes, and especially when the stakes go higher, it is likely that you would see the entrepreneurial university would also go towards patent litigation. Now, there are many instances of taking the research from the lab to the market. And some of these have been done very professionally by professors who have been instrumental from taking the research from the labs to create great companies. Herbert Boyer, a professor from University of California, co-founded the company Genentech, which is one of the leading pharmaceutical companies which involved in biotechnology today. They developed the synthetic human insulin in 1978, and the company itself was acquired by Hoffmann La Roche in 2009. In India, this is an example that I'm aware of. Dr. P. Venkatrangan, who is a leading academic and who was also an alumni of IIT Madras, founded the company called Yodel Inc., an American software company, and which was a commercial success. The MRC Laboratory of Molecular Biology, which is in the University of Cambridge, the work of the scientists have attracted 11 Nobel Prizes. The licensing of LMB's work led to the development of Humira. Humira is a biologic, and it is the world's largest selling drug, which is used for autoimmune diseases. Now, this has generated an income in excess of £700 million from royalties, share sales, and licensing intellectual property. So you can see how important this is, just a glimpse of how intellectual property developed by universities has been perceived in the market.